morning. Amen. I am excited this morning because you know what the Lord told me to open with? The power of breakthrough worship. And I'm going to start with David's Psalm of Gratitude from 1 Chronicles chapter 16. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Show forth from day to day his salvation. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He also is to be reverently feared above all so-called gods. For all the gods of the peoples are lifeless idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty are found in his presence. Strength and joy are found in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, you families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness and in holy array. Tremble and reverently fear before him, all the earth's people. The world also shall be established so it cannot be moved. Let the heavens be glad and let the earth rejoice. And let men say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Let the sea roar and all the things that fill it. Let the fields rejoice and all that is in them. Then shall the trees of the woods sing out for joy before the Lord. For he comes to judge and govern the earth. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. For his mercy and loving kindness endure forever. And then there's some times when our praise and our worship is warfare. It's a battle. And we fight with our praise. We fight with our worship. In 2 Chronicles chapter 2, there was a... am I in the right spot? Hold that thought. 1 Chronicles chapter 2, I don't remember. There was a young king who defeats Moab. And I may... There's also Joshua, right? Went into Jericho. And the Lord said, blow the horn, just like we heard this morning. You blow the horn. You go once around, you blow that horn. On the seventh day, you go seven times around, you blow that horn, and the walls came crumbling down. There's some times that we just need to keep walking and praying and blowing our horn and making that joyful noise until we see those walls come tumbling down. All right, so I'm going to go off memory because I can't find it. I wrote down the wrong scripture this morning. There we go. Thank you, Lord. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. I forgot the zero. Oh, really? Can I borrow it this morning? Jehoshaphat came before the Lord, and the first 15 verses are him telling the Lord all about his problem. The Lord answered very briefly, and he said, "Hearken, ye all Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou King Jehoshaphat, thus saith the Lord unto you, be not afraid nor dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Amen. Tomorrow go ye down against them. Behold, they come up by the cliff of Ziz, and ye shall find them at the end of the brook before the wilderness of Jeruel. Ye shall not need to fight in this battle. Set yourselves, stand ye still, and see the salvation of the Lord with you. O Judah and Jerusalem, fear not, nor be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, for the Lord will be with you." And Jehoshaphat, he bowed his head with his face to the ground. And all Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem fell before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. And the Levites and the children of the Kohathites and the children of the Kohites stood up to praise the Lord God of Israel with a loud voice on high. And they rose early in the morning, and they went forth into the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went forth, Jehoshaphat stood and said, "Hear me, O Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem. Hear me, Des Moines. Hear me, Iowa. Hear me, inhabitants of this nation and this world. Believe in the Lord your God, so shall ye be established. Believe his prophets, so shall ye prosper." And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord, and that should praise the beauty of holiness as they went out before the army, and to say, "Praise the Lord, for his mercy endureth forever." Yes. Getting goosebumps on my goosebumps up here. Yes. Woo! Yes, Lord. And when they began to sing and to praise, the Lord set ambushments against the children of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, which were come against Judah, and they were smitten. We do not need to fight our battles sometimes. Sometimes we just sit and we worship and we pray and we praise. And I'm telling you, there is power in patience. There is power in worship. There is power in our praise. And when we really believe that, we are established, we are rooted, we are grounded. Nothing can shake us, because I'm telling you, this world wants to shake us. The principalities and the powers, they want to come and they want to shake us. They want to make us doubt. They want to make us doubt that our God is who he said he was. They want to make us doubt that he will do what he said he will do. But our God is unmovable. Our God is unshakable, and he has rooted us and grounded us. And when we will stand, and we will stand and say, the battle is not mine, but it's yours, Lord. The battle is yours, Lord. I will trust you and I will praise you, because I'm going to watch the victory all around me. And from that, yes. And from that place, oh, there's a new song that we get to sing. There is a new song. Oh, sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord all the earth. Sing unto the Lord and bless his name, and show forth his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the heathen, his wonders among all the people. For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. And then we are seated in heavenly places, and our worship joins the heavenly worship, and the heavens are open, and we are one, and his kingdom flows, and his glory fills the earth. Amen. And that is the power of breakthrough worship. So, praise the Lord. There's some worshipers in the house today. I'm pretty excited. Woo, I feel your praise, ladies. I'm telling you. I didn't have much for notes today, but woo, I'm excited to see what the Lord's going to do today in this service. Praise the Lord. So this is a time where we just open it up, and anybody that is here today that wants to share a testimony of how good the Lord is, a prayer request, anything that is on your heart this morning, we want to hear from everybody who has something to share this morning. Just raise your hand and or stand up and speak it out. Anybody have anything they want to share this morning? Safe place. It's a safe place. Yes, you sure can.
I'm so glad to be here. Oh, Charlize was a baby where Pastor Steve was dedicating. I don't know if y'all remember that, where Charlize was being dedicated. Oh my goodness, and now, I mean, and you want to hear on time God. I'm coming back. I'm coming back and sing on time God. But here's the psalm the Lord had gave me the name for this group. Psalms 42:4 says, when I remember these things, I pour out my soul within me. For I used to go to with the multitude. I went with them to the house of God.
Yes.
With the voice of joy.
Yes. Amen. Amen. Anyone else this morning? Anyone else? All right. Well, let's. Yeah, James.
I'm thankful. Last week I got sweat on the lip. It's kind of weird. It's muggy and muggy. I can still see it work. And I have another prayer request, an anonymous prayer for my music instructor, Bob. I guess he had some.
Yes, James. Yeah, Tim.
Yes, I want to remember the people in New York this morning, or last night when they had the bombs up there. But, you know, it always tells us that you got to be ready anytime, but you don't know. But, you know, one thing that God was telling me this week, so no matter if it's disaster or anything happened, God's still God in it all.
Yes.
And he doesn't love you less just because you're going through things. He still loves you. That's one message that just permeates through the Bible.
Yeah.
You know, and Jeremiah says, I love you with an everlasting love.
Yes.
And the best thing, God never leave you or forsake you. He'll always be with you. And that's one thing that gets in your heart. So you can always know and remember to look up that God is going to be with you.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Anybody else this morning? All right, well, let's stand and invite the Lord into the service today and lift up prayer requests. Heavenly Father, we just come before you this morning. We enter your courts with thanksgiving. We enter your house with praise, Lord. We come into this house, a house of prayer, Lord, to gather together to lift up your name, the name above all names, Jesus. Come meet with us this morning, Lord. Have your way in the service. We ask that you would bless the worship this morning. We ask that you would bless the word spoken this morning. Let our minds be renewed, Lord. Let our hearts be transformed. Let your glory, let your person be revealed, Lord, that we might know you and be like you. Lord, as those step out in faith in their gifts, Lord, as those come boldly before you, Lord, to offer up a sacrifice of praise, to offer up the gifts in ministry to each other, Lord, in this body. We ask you to bless and increase the gifts, Lord. Bless and increase the revelation, the words of knowledge, the words of prophecy, Lord, the intercession, Lord. And we thank you that we are entering the harvest season where we're going to see the fruit of the seeds that have been sown and planted and watered and tended and weeded for many days, for many weeks, for many months, for many years. We thank you that in you, the answers are always yea and amen, Lord. We come expecting, Lord. We are expecting to meet with you this morning. We are expecting to worship face to face with you today, Lord. What a joy it is to come together in corporate worship, in corporate praise. What a joy it is to pray together. Jesus, be lifted high today, Lord. Be magnified, Lord. Let your glory fill this place. Let the river of your presence flow from the doors of this house into this city, into this state, into this nation. Lord, as we raise your cross high, Lord, we raise up your cross. You died, but you rose again, Lord, in resurrection power. Lord, give us wisdom to speak resurrection life into the dead things that should no longer be dead. To the Lazarus in the tomb that stinks, Lord, it is not too late. It is never too late, Lord, to speak words of life, resurrection life. For our family members, Lord, we understand that things are not as they appear. We understand the truth of your kingdom supersedes the circumstances of this world. And we will not be silent. We will not give up. We will not lose hope. We will not lose heart. Jesus, when those seeds are planted, when we speak your word, it must come to pass and produce what it was sent to do. It must. And we thank you, Lord, that you are faithful. We thank you that you never leave us. You never forsake us, Lord. You never give up on us. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for the restoration, for the reconciliation, and for the resurrection in our lives. Oh, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. To you be all the glory. All the glory. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Oh, thank you. Just a reminder, if you have your cell phone with you, to please put it on silent or turn it off this morning. All right, and we speak the word here together, so we're just going to read the words off the screen together as a body. Will you not revive us again? That your people may rejoice in you, Lord. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the Word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Sister Suzanne. Yeah. She's awesome. She's going to be back here in just a moment to bring forth the word. We're going to take an offering, and y'all want to go ahead and sit down if you like. Hallelujah. 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 Grandpa Juan, Brother Ron, come forth, brother. As the ladies come forth to minister and worship, and James, hallelujah. Just want to thank the Lord for this day. During rehearsal yesterday when these ladies were rehearsing, the glory of God was just shining in this place. I seen the glory in their eyes of the Lord. I heard the angels singing. I heard the angels singing along with these ladies. And see Charlize, when she was a little baby, I remember she was born. Yep, her and Charles and Susan. Oh, yes. And so many times, Charles talking about stomping on the devil, calling him a chump. He'll never leave you or forsake you. It might seem like it's a time and a distance and a place, but he calls it all together in his time and in his way. So, Lord, I pray that you bless this offering. Bless the gift and the giver. Bless those, even those who can't give, Lord, and bless them with a blessing, Lord. For you're a God of abundance. Your grace is abounding, and your love is abounding. So I pray, Lord, as they give, let us now give to you, Lord, and worship and praise that your name would be glorified and magnified in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, Susan. Won't you all come on up now? Come on. Don't be timid. Don't be timid. Hallelujah. Suzanne, come here. Known this young lady for a few years. Go ahead, James, get ready. And she's gone through some things in her life. Her life is a testimony because she's been through the test. All right? I trust her with my life. I trust her with any ministry that the Lord may bring us together in. And last night, I told Cindy about it. I had a dream. I have a dream. There's going to be a women's conference here. Suzanne, Jody Wyckoff, who's Dawn, Susan, and these ladies. There's going to be a women's conference, and I saw it happening on a Friday night and a Saturday night. All right? Something's up. Y'all on it? You're all on it. Okay, Charlize? Francine, Karen, Rhonda, you're all in on this. Be prepared. And this isn't just a one-time thing, but it's coming tonight. It was spoken in the atmosphere several times, but last night it was confirmed. It's on you. It's on you. Don't you back off on me now. All right. So, God bless you. Let's minister in the Lord.
I just wanted to say, you know, when you're faithful with little, God, you'll be faithful with much. And I just remembered, I was kind of scared. I'm like, God, God is big. He's huge. He's unlimited. God go way out. If you want it, you ask him for it. But sometimes we're too scared to ask because he's a big God. I remember starting off with tracks. Y'all remember that?
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, till Charlisa got old enough to be ready. And the Lord said, she's ready. She's ready. I said, God, I don't know what to do. I'm just used to tracks. So, and then they added on.
Woo.
Oh, my God. I don't know. Whoa, and whoa.
Yeah?
I'm ready to praise. Y'all can stand to your feet, worship him, praise him, run around, do what you do.
because of who we are. Because of who he is. We give him the glory.
Because of who you are, I give you glory.
Yeah!
Because of who you are.
Heavenly Father, when we turn to you, when we look to you, keep singing, ladies, keep singing. When we will just lay our when we will lay our burdens down, when we will lay the heaviness that we carry, when we will lay the despair down, the disappointment down, when we lay them at your feet, you bring them back to life, Lord. You give us hope. You give us joy for morning, Lord. But we have to lay it at your feet. We have to trust you. We have to believe your word. We have to believe that you're as good as people say you are. We want to taste your goodness for ourselves, Lord. The Lord says, come and taste and see that I am good. Take a bite, folks. He is here this morning. He said, come and test me. Come and drink of these waters and I will give you life. Come and eat the fruit in my garden. And be restored, be refreshed, be renewed. I will give you a purpose. I will give you a vision. I will lead you every step of the way. I will send a cloud by day to cover you. I will send fire by night to give you light in the darkness. But you have to come to me. You have to come to me and you have to lay it down. You were not created to carry these burdens. They beset us. They distract us. They hold us back from all that God has for us. But these burdens become our friend. They become our companion. It's time to let them go once for all. Time to let it go and just believe. Come and taste and see that the Lord is good. He has promised us and he will never leave us. He will never forsake us. No matter what we have done, no matter the path we have traveled, he promises. His love endures forever. His grace and his mercy is from the east as far as the west. If we will come to him and just find our peace, find our rest. Jesus. Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Sometimes the battle is just to get there and to stand. Thank you, ladies. Thank you for sharing your hearts with us this morning. Thank you for sharing your praise. Thank you for sharing your spirit with us this morning. We rejoice in your voices and your gifts. Thank you. As you have poured out your heart, as you've used your gifts for the Lord, he will multiply it and increase it a thousandfold in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. All right. The children, if there's any children that like to do Sunday school, can be dismissed to go downstairs for Sunday school? Technical aspect. So this morning, Michael, you doing scriptures for me? Oh, Sheila, can you do scriptures? Thank you. Yep, that's okay. I'll just talk. Praise the Lord. Something I'm really good at. Ask my husband. So, you know, sometimes the Lord just gives you a name. Sometimes he gives you a scripture. Sometimes he gives me a topic, and he just says, go with it. So we're going to go with it this morning. We're going to see where it leads. So he told me Joshua and Esther. Now let's see what happens with that, shall we? So I did a little research and come to find out that there's certain portions of the Old Testament that are kind of grouped together, and apparently Joshua is the beginning of the historical books, and Esther is the end of the historical books. So we're going to go from the beginning to the end of the historical books in the Old Testament, and we're going to sprinkle in a whole bunch of New Testament in the middle. So we're going to start with Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 through 18, and we're going to read the story of how Joshua was brought into power as the leader of Israel after Moses. Now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spake unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, thou and all this people, unto the land which I do give to them, even to the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given unto you, as I said unto Moses. From the wilderness and this Lebanon, even unto the great river, the river Euphrates, all of the land of the Hittites, and unto the great sea toward the going down of the sun shall be your coast. There shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. Now that's a promise to stand on. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not fail you, and I will not forsake you. Be strong and of good courage, for unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land, which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous. Let me read that again. Only be thou strong and very courageous. The only requirements that I see him given to Joshua right here. Be strong and be very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper with whithersoever thou goest. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then shalt thou have good success. Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of good courage. In case he missed it the first time, God's going to tell him again. Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither thou be dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee wheresoever thou goest. Then Joshua, right? That's the key. Then Joshua, he did something about it. He didn't think. He didn't wait. He said, yes, Lord. Then Joshua commanded the officers of the people, saying, pass through the host and command the people, saying, prepare your victuals, for within 3 days ye shall pass over this Jordan to go in to possess the land which the Lord your God giveth you to possess it. And to the Reubenites and to the Gadites, to half of the tribe of Manasseh, spake Joshua, saying, remember the word which Moses the servant of the Lord commanded you, saying, the Lord your God hath given you rest and hath given you this land. Your wives, your little ones, and your cattle shall remain in the land which Moses gave you on this side of Jordan. But ye shall pass before your brethren armed, all the mighty men of valor, and help them. Until the Lord hath given your brethren rest, as he hath given you, and they also have possessed the land which the Lord your God giveth them, then you shall return into the land of your possession and enjoy it, which Moses, the Lord's servant, gave you on this side Jordan towards the sun rising. And they answered Joshua, saying, all that thou commandest us we will do, and whithersoever thou sendest us we will go. Now go back to 16 for a second. Sounds a lot like Jesus, doesn't it? And what's he want us to say? He wants our response to be, all that thou commandest us we will do. Wherever you send us, we will go. Wherever you send us, we will go. Just say it, Lord. According as we hearken unto Moses in all things, so we will hearken unto you. Only the Lord thy God be with thee, as he was with Moses. Whosoever he be that doth rebel against thy commandment, and will not hearken unto thy words in all that thou commandest him, he shall be put to death. Only be strong and of good courage. Three times, right? If he tells us three times, he wants us to know it. Write that one in stone in your heart. So what was the, this is a pop quiz, what was the one requirement God had? Be strong and very courageous. That's all he asked of Joshua. And isn't it the same thing he asked us today? Be strong. Don't give up. Don't lose hope. Don't turn to the right. Don't turn to the left. But be strong and be very courageous. There were giants in the land. I don't see Joshua worrying about the giants. He saw the giants. He was one of the spies. And he said, yes, Lord, we can. He came back to the camps. He said, yes, it's good. But there's giants. Did you not see them, Joshua? Oh, I just saw the fruit that I'm going to eat. The grapes as big as the baskets. I'm going to eat that. That's all he saw. Because he was looking through some different glasses. He had different vision. He knew who God was. And he heard. Right? We can hear, but do we hear? Do we comprehend what the Lord tells us? And now I'm going to fast forward to Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20. There was another death in the family, and there was another transfer of power. Matthew 28, 18 through 20. And Jesus came after he rose again, after he had been seen by Mary and Magdalene. This is the last passage in Matthew of the account of before Jesus rose and ascended. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Sounds a lot like what God told Joshua. Only then it was just for the Israelites, right? Yes. Now it's for all nations. It's for whosoever will. Because Jesus said, I'm gonna be the law that lives in your heart. I am obedience. I am perfect obedience, so you can just go. I took care of that part. Now you just go. You just go. Let's go back to Joshua, chapter 3, verses 14 through 17. Because how many of you know when God does something, he does it perfectly? He does it perfectly. Joshua 3, verses 14 through 17. And it came to pass, when the people were moved from their tents to pass over Jordan, and the priests bearing the Ark of the Covenant before the people, and as they that bear the ark were come into Jordan, and the feet of the priests that bear the ark were dipped in the brim of the water, for the Jordan overfloweth all his banks at the time of harvest, that the waters which come down from above stood and rose up upon a heap very far from the city Adam, that is beside Zaratan, and those that came down toward the sea of the plain, even the salt sea, failed and were cut off, and the people passed over right against Jericho. And the priests that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord stood firm on dry ground in the midst of the Jordan. And all the Israelites passed over on dry ground until all the people were passed clean over Jordan. Has anybody ever walked in a pond or a river? There's a monkey mess in the bottom of it. And God said, they're not passing over in a monkey mess. He rolled back every drop of water. He will make a way where there is no way. Every drop of water. Not one. Not, their garments were not full of mud. That ark didn't get stuck in the mud. That's not fun to get stuck in the mud. They pass clean over on dry ground. The Lord will roll back the waters if we will believe, and if we will let his presence will always lead us over on dry ground, no matter where the journey may take us. Let's go to Acts 2, verses 1 through 4. The Lord has prepared the ground for us. Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a mighty rushing wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. The Lord put his Spirit in us. That ark of the covenant that passes over now dwells in human flesh. We have become the ark of his presence. We have become the temple of the one true living God. Everywhere we go, everywhere our feet go, we pass on dry ground. Everywhere we go. Acts 2, verses 15 through 21. The Lord has done it all. All we got to do is walk over. We got to cross over. He's going to walk across on dry ground. For these are not drunken as ye suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day. It's 9 o'clock in the morning. I don't think they're drunk already. But this is that which was spoken of by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, we're in the last days still, saith God, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants, on the people who follow me, the people who believe in me, the people who trust me, I, and on my handmaidens, got a special blessing for us ladies, and I will pour out in those days, I will pour out in those days of my Spirit, and they all shall prophesy, and I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapors of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and notable day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. We have called upon the name of the Lord. We are saved. But now, it's our job to carry that ark and cross the river and tell those who haven't heard the good news, to tell those who don't understand when we, how, I know what you're going through. How on earth can you be so full of joy? How on earth are you not just falling apart? Because I am standing on a rock that is unmovable. And wherever I walk on dry ground. I don't have mud on my boots. Because I walk on dry ground, and everywhere I go, I carry his presence with me, and I change the atmosphere. We have the authority. The power is his, but he has given us the authority to walk in it, to live in it, to breathe in it, to move and have our being. That's now I want to talk about Jericho. This is my favorite of all of the battles. Now, Joshua is known as one of the greatest military leaders of all time, and his first great battle was won by marching and blowing a horn. I'm telling you, the things of the Lord are foolishness to this world. Because if you go tell somebody, I'm going to win a battle, I've been fighting, I've been praying years, I'm going to go march, and I'm going to blow a horn once a day for 6 days. And on the seventh day, watch out. I'm telling you, watch out, because I'm going seven times and the walls are coming down. But that is exactly what happened. And that was the beginning of all of the destruction of Cana and the creation of the Promised Land. The establishment of the Promised Land to the north and to the south. I think he had one little hiccup. And then it was nothing but victory for Joshua. Joshua knew nothing but victory. Can you imagine? Can you see in your mind a life full of nothing but victory? Nothing but victory. And I'm telling you, if you will hang on, you will see nothing but victory. It may take some time to get there. A day with the Lord can be, I feel like, 1,000 years. And that seventh day, it can drag. Oh, we're still on day 3, Lord. Oh, day 4, Lord, I'm hanging on. I'm standing strong. But you just wait. You hold on, because the seventh day will always come if we will just wait. There is power in waiting upon the Lord. What does the Bible say? Wait upon the Lord, and you and I will renew your strength, like, and you will soar like the eagles. There is power in the waiting. And boy, they knew how to wait because they worshiped, didn't they? They sent the worshipers out before the army. So let's read about Joshua. Joshua chapter 6, verse 1 through 21. We're going to read the whole thing. I don't want to paraphrase it. I'm just going to read you the story. Scripture's always good. Now Jericho was straightly shut up because of the children of Israel. They were freaking out because they heard about this people that just walked across a river that was flooded on dry ground. What? Who are these people? Shut the city up. None went out and none came in. They were walled up. And the Lord said unto Joshua, see, I have given unto thine hand Jericho and the king thereof and the mighty men of valor. And ye shall compass the city, all ye men of war, and go round about the city once. That thus shalt thou do 6 days. And 7 priests shall bear the ark, 7 trumpets of ram's horns. And the 7th day ye shall compass the city 7 times, and the priests shall blow with the trumpets. And it shall come to pass that when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when ye hear the sound of the trumpet, all the people shall shout with a great shout, and the wall of the city shall fall down flat, and the people shall ascend up, every man straight before him. And Joshua, the son of Nun, called the priests and said unto them, take up the ark of the covenant. Let 7 priests bear 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark of the Lord. And he said unto the people, pass on, encompass the city, and let him that is armed pass on before the ark of the Lord. And it came to pass, when Joshua had spoken unto the people, that the 7 priests bearing the 7 trumpets of ram's horns passed on before the Lord and blew the trumpets. And the, oh, sorry, go back. That's okay. I don't have it memorized, sorry. And the ark of the covenant of the Lord followed them. And the armed men went before the priest that blew the trumpet, and the reward came after the ark, and the priest going on and blowing with the trumpets. And Joshua had commanded the people, saying, ye shall not shout, nor make any noise with your voice. No complaining. That's a tough one. Neither shall any word proceed out of your mouth until the day I bid you shout, then ye shall shout. There is something about our silence sometimes. There is something about just holding it. I'm telling you, it's a sacrifice. I'm a talker. It's a sacrifice. But when we hold, because I'm telling you, waiting, it's really hard sometimes not to start complaining, telling God all about our problems. He says, just hold it. And on the 7th day, you shout the victory. But you hold it. So the ark of the Lord compassed the city, going about it once. And they came into the camp and lodged in the camp. And Joshua rose early in the morning, and the priests took up the ark of the Lord. And 7 priests bearing 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark of the Lord went on continually and blew with the trumpets. And the armed men went before them, but the reward came after the ark of the Lord, and the priests going on and blowing with the trumpets. And the 2nd day they compassed the city once and returned into the camp. So they did 6 days. And it came to pass on the 7th day that they rose early out of the dawning of the day. How many of you know there's a special blessing that comes by getting up early in the dawning of the day? There's a special blessing that comes when that sun rises in the east. There's something special about that dawn hour. If you are seeking something, if you're needing a breakthrough, I tell you, set an alarm. Get up early. And if you don't, God will wake you up sometimes. I don't know about anybody else, but God wakes me up. If I hit snooze, he said, nope, you're getting up. Encompass the city after the same manner 7 times. Only on that day they compassed the city 7 times. And it came to pass at the 7th time, when the priests blew with the trumpets, Joshua shouted, said unto the people, shout, for the Lord has given you the city. Now at this point, not one thing had changed, right? Not one thing had changed, but he said, God has, we've done everything. Now shout, and God has given you the city. And the city shall be accursed, even it, and all that are therein to the Lord. Only Rahab the harlot shall live, she and all that are within her house, because she hid the messenger that we sent. And ye, in any wise, keep yourselves from the accursed thing, lest ye make yourselves accursed, when ye take of the accursed thing and make camp of Israel a curse and trouble it. There were rules, right? You guys can have all of the city, but these few things, don't take those. Everything else? But all the silver and the gold and the vessels of brass and iron are consecrated unto the Lord. They shall come into the treasury of the Lord. So the people shouted when the priests blew the trumpets, and it came to pass, when the people heard the sound of the trumpet, and the people shouted with a great shout, that the wall fell down flat, so that the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they took the city. And they utterly destroyed all that was in the city, both man and woman and young and old, and ox and sheep and ass with the edge of the sword. Sometimes battle in the Old Testament was bloody. Now, we don't deal with that physical, the bloodiness of battle, the swords, the killing of women and children. We don't deal with that. But our spiritual battles can be just as painful, just as bloody, just as gory, right? Because we're dealing with some situations and some circumstances in people's lives that can be very troubling. But when we will wait on the Lord, when we will wait on Him in patience and worship, that's when things can change and when those walls come tumbling down. So Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. So after the Holy Spirit fell, this is the first outing, I guess you can say, of the apostles, right? This is the first time we see what it looks like, being filled with the Holy Ghost and going out and doing whatever they do, right? Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. Now Peter and John went up together, because now, remember, these guys had just won the victory, right? The walls of death, hell, and the grave had been destroyed, and they were filled with the Holy Ghost. So their wall had just come down, and this is what victory looks like. Now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. And a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Who seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked an alms, asked for money. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, look on us, look at me. And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up. And immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. And he leaping up, stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God, and they knew that it was him which sat for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto him. And as the lame man which was healed held Peter and John, all the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon's, greatly wondering. And when Peter saw it, he answered unto this people, ye men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness we had made this man walk? There's power and there's authority. I mentioned this a minute ago, right? It's not our power. People look at us and think, why are you so special? Let me tell you, I'm not. But my God is very special. He is different. He is unique. He is powerful. And he has sealed me with his Holy Spirit. He has put a badge, his badge on my forehead. I am an ambassador of heaven. I have all of the authority to walk in all of the kingdom glory. I have the authority, the serpent, you know, tread on serpents, raise the dead. I have the authority. He has put the power, that dunamis power is in me. That Holy Spirit that raised Christ from the dead, the same resurrection power is in me. But do we know it? Do we remember it? It is so easy that the enemy besets us and gets us to look right or left or forget who we are. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. You know, I think it was Paul who said, I don't want to see anything in you but Christ and him resurrected. I don't want to see anything in anyone but Christ and him resurrected, because it's his power, it's his authority, it's his kingdom. But our minds need to be renewed. We have to be transformed into his likeness to understand that when I screw up, right, when I have a moment that I'm not walking by the Spirit, okay, so I'm not perfect. My husband's here. He can give me an amen. I might lose my temper. I might have a moment. But that doesn't make me anything less value in the kingdom of God. It doesn't change my anointing. It doesn't change my purpose. It doesn't change who I am, because that means that it diminishes who he is. There is nothing that I can do to diminish the power of the blood of Jesus. There is nothing that I can do that can diminish the resurrection power that abides in me. But we let the enemy convince us that unless we're perfect, unless we're living a holy life, unless we're doing this, doing that, checking the boxes, doing this, I got bad news. You can check all the boxes you want. It's going to get you nowhere. There are no jewels waiting for your crown, because the crown is Jesus. We're supposed to give him our crowns. I'm not storing up rubies to put in my big fancy crown. It's his crown. So just let it go. That's my husband's revelation to me this fall. Let it go. 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 I don't have to own that. I don't have to wear that burden. I don't have to be perfect. I just have to love. I just have to love as Christ loved. You know the easiest thing it is for us to do as human beings? To love. You know the scariest thing for us to do as human beings? To love. It is so scary to love people who want to just kick dirt on your love, isn't it? It hurts because you're giving your heart, you're giving your spirit. And they say, I don't want that. But it's not you they're rejecting, remember? What Jesus tells, it's him. They don't understand. They don't know how good he is. They haven't tasted and seen how good he is. It's not us that they're rejecting. But Jesus said, love them anyway. Love them anyway. And eventually those seeds, you may not see it. You may not ever see it in your lifetime, but those seeds are going to bear fruit. I can tell you, there were some seeds planted early in my life. And then I just took a little detour. I grew up in a Baptist church. I knew nothing about the gifts of the Spirit. I knew nothing. And then all of a sudden, I found myself a single parent in my 20s going, my life is empty. Empty. No meaning. What am I doing? I have a little kid. I like church growing up. I'm gonna take my kid to a church. That's good for him. Yeah. So I asked a friend that I knew as a Christian. I said, I want to go to a church. Tell me about your church. She goes, honey, I'm not gonna tell you about my church. I'm gonna tell you about Jesus. You don't need a church, you need Jesus. And I thank God for her, because I'm telling you, so many times people think they need a church. Church is not gonna fix anything. The church is not gonna change anything. Jesus changes everything. Thank God. Now just remember that when someone says, let's tell you about your church. Let me tell you about Jesus. Because it is so important. If we are not in a body where we fit, where we belong, we are not going to function properly. And we're going to get all kinds of bitter. We're going to get all kinds of disappointed. We're going to be offended with each other. It's not about any of that. It's about finding a body where you can function, where your gifts are needed, where your callings are needed, and where you can reveal Christ. Looks different for everybody. So, again, I mentioned that sometimes the things the Lord asks us to do, the things of the Spirit, are foolishness to this world, right? So, how many times I've had people pray, there's two people in this room right now, or I may have taken a lap around a house, or I may have told them to take a lap around a house, remember? And we prayed. And I'm telling you, it seems foolish to take a lap around a house for somebody you may not know. I know Sheila, I've told you, take the anointing oil, take a lap around your house. It seems kind of crazy, but that is what the Lord says, will you trust me? Will you trust me and do the foolish things? Because then I can do the big things. If you'll trust me in the little things, I will handle the big things. All it is walking the ground, taking authority, and saying, I trust you, Lord. I trust you, Lord. And this is my other favorite saying, things are not as they appear. Things are not as they appear. We do not battle flesh and blood. We do not battle people. We battle the principalities and powers of darkness of the air. And they are cunning, and they are liars. But boy, are they good liars. They are good liars, but they are liars. And I'm telling you, and it's just like, I don't remember where I heard that, you know, that you don't need to know what every counterfeit bill looks like. You just need to know what the real one looks like. If you know the truth, all the lies, it don't matter. You know, because the lies can sound a lot like scripture. You know, the enemy tempted Jesus, and he gave him some scripture-ish. And the Lord answered and said, no, you got to have the Spirit to guide you and lead you. So let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 25 through 27. Just reminder that the God uses the foolish things to confound the wise. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For ye see your calling, excuse me, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. So good news. The more we feel inferior, the more we feel unimportant, the more we feel diminished, God says, I can use that. Because now you can come on me, and you can come to me and lean on me, and it's my strength that will renew you. It's my strength that will empower you, right? He wants it to be his power, not ours. We got to lay it all down. And I don't want to get to the end of my rope before I got to hang on, you know? I don't want to live that way. That's not any way to live, and that's not how God tells us to live. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 6 through 14. And the things of the Spirit are foolishness to the flesh. 1 Corinthians 2, 6 through 14. Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom, which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the hearts of man, the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. Can't even imagine the goodness. Can't even imagine. I can imagine some good stuff, but that tells me that I don't even have the creativity to imagine all the good things God has for us. Verse 12. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God, which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. So all of that to say, then take a PhD, right? It just takes a heart willing to say, teach me, Lord. I love the Bible, but this isn't where the power is. The power is in the Word. God doesn't need me to read this to give me the Word, right? It's wonderful to have it, and it's wonderful to do it, but memorizing scripture doesn't change anything. Now, when I understand it, and when I speak it, when I speak that rhema word, that living word, it may not sound like it, but it's the living word. And when I speak the living word of God, things change. The atmosphere changes. Our circumstances change. People's hearts can change. But our minds are going, what? You want me to do what? You want me to anoint a door? You want me to what? You want me to anoint a car? What? I mean, they're foolish things, right? And the more foolish, the more I'm like, oh, it must be the Lord, because I'm certainly not going to make that up, right? So that's our comfort, is to know the more foolish it seems. All right, Lord, let's go. All right, so that ends kind of where I was going with Joshua. And I don't have a really smooth transition, but I'm going to talk about Esther for a little bit. And I was kind of wondering until I got here and Mike mentioned the women's ministry. I think this is just a short little smidgen just for the ladies. Sorry, men. There's some good things that everybody can learn from Esther, but I think there's a special anointing for the women from the book of Esther this morning. And I'm going to try and wrap up fairly briefly, and then I want to do some praying and some impartation. The book of Esther is definitely my favorite book of the Bible, and sometimes when you read the Bible, you just relate to a character. You know, you just relate. I don't know how else to say it. You're like, oh, I get this. I get this person. I connect with this person. Something in their life, something about their story you just connect with. And for me, that's always been Esther. And so there's so many lessons from this short book. And I'm sure that probably the most quoted scripture is about, you know, and who knoweth whether thou art come into the kingdom for such a time as this. And that's a whole sermon in and of itself, right, for the season, right, for just this time. And I'm always confounded to think that the Lord chose every single one of us for this day, for this time. And we could have been born at any time in history, but he chose us for right now. And our God does everything on purpose. He has a plan. He knows the end from the beginning. And he has chosen every single one of you to be here today, to hear this message, to hear these beautiful ladies sing, to be part of this service, right? And so, who knows? Every circumstance in the back of our mind, who knows? Was I created for just this moment? Because how many know if you miss it, sometimes you got to take another lap in the desert. I don't want to take a lap in the desert. I don't want to miss it, you know? I want to just be aware. And so I've got just a few bullet points that I picked as the kind of the key cornerstones of what I've learned through the book of Esther. And Esther always did the work necessary to be prepared before the situation would arise, right? That's something she was always preparing. And one of my favorite women's Bible study that I taught on was a season of soaking. Esther prepared for a year. She took these oil baths with fragrances and spices, and she did all these things to be beautiful for a year. She prepared every day for a year for one night with the king. Could have been just one night, because if he wasn't pleased with her, that was all she got, was one night. For a year, she soaked. For a year, so that when she walked into a room, she emitted a fragrance. Oh, I'm telling you, when we soak ourselves in the presence of God, we emit a fragrance that this world goes, ooh, that's different. What's different about them? They just don't even know. People, I don't know how many of you guys have this happen. You're in line at the grocery store, people want to tell you their life story. And you end up having a conversation. Let me pray for you. They didn't even know. They just start talking to you. They're just drawn to you. They don't even know why. Because you emit a fragrance after spending time with the king. Prayer and fasting. Once she knew she had a difficult decision to make, did she just make the decision? No, she said, Mordecai, I want you to tell all the people to pray for me. I'm going to fast. And I'm going to seek the Lord to know what to do in this difficult situation. There's times when we got to pray and we got to fast. I don't hear a lot of teaching about fasting anymore. I'm not telling you that you got to fast to get an answer from God, but I'm telling you there's a blessing that comes when you will pray and you will fast about a situation when you need an answer. If something is just, even if it's just to change our own heart, just to pray and to fast, there's something special there. One of the other things, Esther sought out wise counsel and didn't make important decisions alone. How many of you know the enemy loves to get us off by ourselves, thinking we're all by ourselves, all alone, nobody here to help me, and boy, they can just come and nip at us. It's those little things that spoil the vine, right? Don't let yourself be caught off alone. We have a body of believers, you know, friends, somebody, find somebody you can call. Don't ever let yourself get off alone, and that is wisdom from God, to never let yourself be caught off guard and alone. And remember, we're never alone, right? God is always with us. We are never alone, but sometimes we don't feel his presence like we do at other moments. We shouldn't have to physically feel him to remember that we are never alone. He is always with us. And Esther trusted God to give her favor. You know, when she walked in, she knew when she was walking into the king's chamber, she knew he kind of liked her, right? Kept her around, made her queen. Hopefully if I go in, I'm breaking the rules. This is against the rules. You don't ever go into the king's chamber without permission. But he has his scepter. And if he extends his scepter to me, then I'm good to go. And she walked in knowing, well, he's either going to or he isn't, but I'm dead either way, right? It was all for her and all the Jews, all her family, all her people. And she went and she trusted that she would have favor with the king. But she knew that she had to have favor with her God first, which is why she went through the prayer and the fasting. And she did find favor with the king. And Esther knew that if she waited and trusted God and followed the wisdom that he gave her, her enemies would be destroyed by their own evil plots. This is probably my favorite thing to talk about in the book of Esther. There are people, spirits, enemies, plotting, setting up traps, laying in wait to snare us, to capture us, to distract us. But I'm telling you, if we will wait on the Lord, if we will ask for his wise counsel, the enemy will be destroyed by their own evil plans for us. It was his own noose in his own yard that Haman was hung from, intended for Mordecai. But it was not Mordecai that died in that. It was Haman himself. He had prepared his own death. It was his evil that got the caught up with him. So I'm telling you, if we can just wait on the Lord, he will give us wisdom. And we don't have to worry about it. All she did, she had a feast, and she invited Haman into the feast. And then, you know, waited until the time was right. Wait, she was so patient. Whew, I can learn a lesson. I don't want to pray for patience. Everybody always says, don't pray for patience, it brings trial. But there is a blessing from eating the fruit of patience and a wisdom that comes. And because of all of these things, Esther was a woman of great influence in a man's world. Women were not of high power, of high value in that day, in that age, in Xerxes' kingdom, especially in that time in the world. But she was a woman of great influence. Thank you so much. She was a woman of great influence. She sought God. She was open to wisdom, and she was able to save all the nation of Israel by her actions. The enemy wants to tell us that we're of no importance, right? You ain't gonna make a difference. What you do doesn't matter. I'm telling you it matters, because you are a person of influence, every one of you. And the only requirement, remember what the Lord told us earlier, the only requirements? Be strong and very courageous. Esther was strong and very courageous, and God used her mightily to save a people. And if it wasn't for Esther, there wouldn't have been a Jesus. You know? So, as I was trying to put these two together, I got nothing. So, other than, you know, Esther's, I underline a woman of great influence, and I think that our women's conference is women of influence. And I think that that's what that whole thing was all about, was to establish women of influence. So anyway, pray about that. And as I was, I keep coming back to Zechariah, and I feel like we are in a season, right? There's been a death in the family. There's been a transfer of power. And God is looking at us and saying, will you cross over? Will you go into the promised land? Will you go take the kingdom? I will slay the giants. I will bring down the walls, but I need somebody to go. I need somebody to walk the walls. I need somebody to blow the horn. There's something powerful when those shofars get blown. It shakes things. And boy, the enemy does not like it. But there is a victory. There is a victory that I don't see as often as I think we should. We are to walk in victory. And I think sometimes we forget. Zechariah chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. And I'll wrap up with this. Zechariah chapter 4, verses 6 through 7. Then he answered and spake unto me, saying, this is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. Who art thou, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, thou shalt become a plain. And he shall bring forth the headstone thereof with shoutings, crying, grace, grace unto it. Now, that is a whole message in and of itself, but I'm telling you, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit. When we will let the Holy Spirit lead, when we will listen to what the Holy Spirit says, when we will see what the Holy Spirit tries to show us, when we will allow the gifts of the Spirit to be stirred up and to be in use. Who art thou, O great mountain? Jesus told us mountains will become foothills. You speak to that mountain, and it shall be removed and cast into the sea. You speak to the mountain. Wow. Jesus is silent now. His spirit is in our hearts. We are his voice. We are the ones that he has called to speak to the mountains. Yes. Wow. Not by power, not by might, but by his spirit. When we speak spirit words, when we speak the rhema word, the living word of God, mountains shall become plains. Mountains shall be moved and cast into the sea. And what do we say to those mountains? Grace. Grace unto it. Grace and grace unto it. That is what we say to everything. Grace. Grace unto it. That's what Jesus says to us. Grace. Grace to you. Grace. Grace to you. I see you through grace. I see you perfect. I see you holy. And I see you sitting in a pew when you should be crossing. I'm just kidding. It's time to possess the land. It is time to cross over and possess the promised land. And this is a call to the Joshuas and to the Esthers. Now is the time. You were created. You were purposed for such a time as this, every one of you. And I need the Joshuas to rise up and take and speak to the mighty men of valor. There are mighty men of valor who have been hiding in caves waiting for a Joshua to come and lead them. I need a Joshua. Where's my Joshuas? I need Joshuas to come and lead those mighty men of valor. It's time to get out of the caves and start marching in victory. Into my Esthers, the season of soaking is done. Now go into the presence of the king and use your influence. Your season of soaking, your season of obscurity, your season of preparation. It is done. You are complete. You are holy. You are righteous. You are acceptable in the beloved. Now you go before the king and you expect favor, and it will transform nations. It will transform this world. So I'm telling you, I want everybody to stand up, and we're just going to pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Joshuas. We thank you for the Joshuas who are rising up even now. That they are calling out to the mighty men of valor. They're gathering the mighty men of valor even right now. Joshuas, we bless you, Joshuas. We bless you, Joshuas. We will cover you in prayer. We will pray for you. We'll pray for your families. We'll pray for your boldness. We'll pray for you to be strong and very courageous. You are more than a conqueror. God says, I have given you the city. Now come and see the day of your salvation. Come and see as I will remove the walls. I will slay the giants and you will eat the fruit of land. You will live in houses you did not build. But come and possess the land. Heavenly Father, we pray for the Esthers. Women of influence. Whew, I thank you, Lord, for that season of soaking. I thank you for the fragrance. Whew, I thank you for your favor. And I thank you as you call us out of that season of preparation. You call us into the throne room. And we thank you, Lord, that you extend the scepter of favor. And I thank you that whatever we ask, your answers are yea and amen, but we need you to call forth the Esthers, Lord. Call forth the Esthers. Call forth the Esthers for such a time as this, to minister to the kings, to give wisdom to the kings, Lord, to bring forth their fragrance, to come out of the caves. I feel like we have been hiding in caves. Your people have been waiting, but now is the time to come out. And when the Esthers and the Joshuas will come out together, your kingdom is revealed from beginning to end. You have created a nation and you have saved a nation from beginning to end. And we rewrite history together, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that your kingdom is revealed through the Joshuas and the Esthers. Thank you that your dunamis power, your resurrection power, your rhema word will be spoken by the Joshuas and the Esthers. And we ask a blessing for every person here today, Lord. Stir up the gifts in everybody here today, Lord. Stir up the gifts in your church. Let us speak to the mountains and watch them be cast into the sea. Oh, Zerubbabel, who can stand before the Lord? And we will say grace, grace to it. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Well, that is our service. If anybody wants to have additional prayer or time of ministry, Michael's going to put on some music for us, and we can gather in the front. Fellowship ministry, the formal service is over in Jesus' name. Amen.